God, have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. in the Eternal City. These nationalist revolutionaries continued to threaten not only Rome, but nearly all of Europe in different ways. It was some 5 years before, whilst in exile in Gaeta, that Blessed Pius IX stood in front of a window watching a storm and thinking of the storm that was threatening the bark of Peter. And one of his most trusted advisors said this: "Most Blessed Father, you can heal the world only with a proclamation of the dogma of the Immaculate Conception." In 1950, Venerable Pius XII saw a Europe recovering from the ravages of war, which had seen millions die not only in bombing raids and military actions, but in a genocide that shocked the world. In the 5 years between the end of the war and 1950, Pius XII had seen the rise and spread of communism, in which many more millions would be killed on the altar of that false religion. Seeing devastation and hunger and evil wherever he looked, Pius XII would act similarly to Blessed Pius IX, and he proclaimed to the world the dogma of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. In the Apostolic Constitution defining the dogma of the Assumption, Unifecitissimus Deus, Pius XII wrote this: "And so we may hope that those who meditate upon the glorious example of Mary offers us, may be more and more convinced of the value of a human life entirely devoted to carrying out the Heavenly Father's will and to bringing good to others. Thus, while the illusory teachings of materialism and the corruption of morals that follows from these teachings threaten to extinguish the light of virtue and to ruin the lives of men by exciting discord among them, in this magnificent way, all may see clearly to what a lofty goal our bodies and souls are destined." The response of the Church, therefore, to the evils of this world, naturally and properly, is a spiritual response. Not that the spiritual is opposed to or excludes the practical. That kind of opposition exists only in the perverted minds of secularists. No, the Church saw the primacy of the spiritual and the supernatural order and acted accordingly. The popes had seen real and pervasive evil that results from the forces of organized naturalism, whatever name they happen to be known by in their age. Naturalism, materialism, liberalism, socialism, and communism are all evil anti-Christian ideologies that, in seeking to create heaven on earth, end up creating hell instead. The Church sees this naturalism and she responds with supernaturalism. And to whom does Mother Church turn in these moments of crisis but to the Blessed Virgin Mary? The dogma of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary was a response, therefore, to the evils of the world, a response to the spiritual evils that accompany total war, and an act of hope and belief in the power of grace. With horrors behind him, and indeed horrors ahead of him, the Pope praised and gave glory to God by venerating what God had done in the Blessed Virgin Mary. The powerful, strong men of Europe who had caused such untold damage to the lives and souls of millions found the image of their defeat in a woman from first century Palestine, whom God had chosen to call to himself in body and soul. Evil, therefore, is shown to be something like a firework, loud, bright, and full of fire, but ephemeral. Whereas the love of God is shown to us in the union of Mary to her Son and Lord. a love that death cannot end, a love stronger than death. The Blessed Virgin was the first to fully experience the life-changing and restoring love of God that we call grace, for she it was that was full of grace. This love which filled her, created her, and loved her was made flesh in her womb for us men and for our salvation. It was she who was there at the first public miracle of our Lord, the wedding at Cana, and she who was there at the foot of the cross as she was given to be mother of the whole church. She who suffered so much and loved so much, who would carry the cross of Christ, her son, in her heart all her days. Yet too, the Blessed Virgin would share in the glory of her son. Today, dear brothers, we are taught the primacy of the supernatural, the primacy of love, when the Blessed Virgin is drawn to her divine son and by her divine son at the end of her earthly life. Precisely because of her union and communion with her son, the Lord and the Blessed Virgin, his mother, are not to be separated, even for an instant. Such is the power of love and the primacy that it must hold in our lives. We too stand before a world in crisis. We see fear, timidity, and irreligion around us and indeed inside us. Crises of faith and faithlessness, desolation and hunger. And our response must be the perennial response of Holy Mother Church, to confront natural evils and the evils of naturalism with the primacy of the supernatural, that is, to build up the city of God. The primacy, exalted and exalted, of love that we see in this feast, love that is stronger than death. This was said much more eloquently by another, and some of you might recall hearing these words. The Church in all its trials was characterized by a quite visible manifestation of an internalized grasp of the primacy of the supernatural order, and we do need to recover that in the Church now, and in our life in the order, and in our own lives. We need, if we are to be disciples of our Holy Father Augustine, to keep our eyes fixed on the building up of the city of God and averted from the life of the earthly city, which is always going to remain meaningless to us. These words which Father Caddock spoke to us in the retreat he gave us some years ago. Let us therefore, dear brothers, commend ourselves to our Heavenly Mother, assumed body and soul into heaven, where she sees God face to face. Let us remember that we are called to that union too at the end of our earthly lives, that only if, like her, we see the primacy of the supernatural order and put that primacy into practice in our lives. For the sanctuary of God in heaven is open, and the Ark of the Covenant can be seen inside it. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Passion, God,
Thank you.
Virgin Mary, whom you assumed into heaven, may our hearts aflame with the fire of love, constantly long for you, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you, and with your spirit. Lift up your hearts. Since from her own body she marvelously brought forth in your incarnate Son, the author of all life. And so, in the company of the prophets of angels, we praise you and may joy be proclaimed.
Be pleased to grant her peace to God, unite and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis Harper and Alan, our bishop, and all those who hold into the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you this sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Peter, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John, and Paul, Cosmas, and Daniel, and all your saints, ask that, through their merits and prayers, in all things we may be defended by your protecting help, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven to O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given for you." Grant them, O Lord, we pray, all who speak in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hoping your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share of fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not paying our merits, but granting us your power, through Christ our Lord. Amen. to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you.
Brought to the glory of